بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين، وأصلي وأسلم على نبيه الكريم عليه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. My brothers and sisters in Islam, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I had a very interesting last few hours. So sitting down, preparing, you know, something very nice, going through some slides, and you know, I was going to share the Quebec City experience with you. So I think I mentioned it to you 2 weeks ago that I was going to Quebec City to visit the masjid where the shooting happened, and to also visit the families of those who you know, had loved ones that were shot and, you know, killed. But after I was done, I came down to my living room and sat down, and my wife asked me, what are you teaching tonight? And I said, I'm going to teach about that, and I'm going to talk about it, the experience, and show some pictures and stuff like that. And she said, that's too graphic. It's a family halaqa. It's not good. Some children, you know, might be a little bit too difficult for them to handle. And so I really don't know what to do now. So I thought, you know, subhanAllah, I'll share the experience, but I won't go through too many of the details on purpose because there are children here. Despite that, subhanAllah, I have personally shared this with my children, right? So my children, one of them is 3, the other one is 6. Now, my children don't watch movies, they don't see the graphic, you know, expression of shooting and killing and death and so on from movies and TV shows and video games and so on and so forth. They don't get to see that and experience it, so they don't really have this image in their mind. So I don't really want to base my experience with my children and equal it or compare it to the experience that other people's children might have, because for every single one of us, the way we raise our children is different, right? And so some children might have seen certain things in movies and not really experience it in real life, or not actually meet someone who says, you know what, that was real. This really happened. This actually took place. So if anyone here has any issues or objections, let me know right now. If not, I could be a little graphic, right? You all know me, subhanAllah. Any issues? Anyone concerned? No, no one concerned at all? If anyone is, raise your hand, just let me know, wink, you know, raise your hand, something, I don't know, indicate to me that you are. The sisters, okay, they're there. They're right there, subhanAllah. So what I'll do is, again, I won't go through some of the other stuff because there are pictures that were... you know, from the day after the shooting and so on, and you actually see, you know, blood and stuff smeared on the walls and the floors and the carpets and so on. I won't show any of that, inshallah ta'ala. In fact, I'll just speak about the experience. And I really wanted to share that with us so that we can understand, as Muslims, how we should not really be scared. And this was something that I noticed happened, and I spoke to many other imams around the GTA, and in different parts of Canada as well, asking some of the imams, did you notice that there was a number or a drop in the number of Muslims that came to the congregational prayers immediately after the shooting in Quebec City? And many of them, in fact, I think all of them said yes. I can't really remember any of them that said no, you know, we just noted it was the same. It was exactly the same. Every single one of them said yes. It was apparent that there was a drop in numbers, or there was a serious concern for our security system to be heightened, to be up to date, to be, you know, just as powerful, if not even more or better than it was already. And so, subhanAllah, that is something that's drastic and real. That took place right here in our own country, within our own Muslim community. Let me just get my adapter, inshallah. Bismillah. let's do this. Okay. Oh, mashallah, it's romantic. Alhamdulillah. Okay, so here you see... Interesting, eh? Okay, so here you'll see a slide in front of us, subhanAllah, and it's just a picture that I literally took from, I think it's the Globe and Mail. I just took this picture just so that we could see the six people, and I'll speak about each one of these, inshaAllah ta'ala. What happened was when we went to Quebec City, I went with Canada Zakat and Da'wah Net. I think most of you are familiar with Canada Zakat, Da'wah Net. They're the ones that organized Muslim Fest, the My Voice magazine, and so on and so forth. Various different projects that they do, Understanding Islam Academy, and so on. So they invited me to go down to Quebec City, or to go up to Quebec City, I should say, because it's more north, to visit the families of these brothers. Now, these were the brothers that were shot and killed in the masjid in Quebec City on that night. Which night was it now? January 29, I think it was, right? Around that, the end of January. And so, subhanAllah, these brothers that you see in front of you, we'll start with Brother Khalid, right? Who's this brother right here in the middle. Top in the middle. I think you could see my mouse moving there, right? So this brother, Brother Khalid. In fact, what I'll do is I'll tell you exactly what happened. Okay, I'll tell you exactly what happened. So the brothers went for Isha. They went to pray Isha in the masjid, just like Isha is coming up right now, okay? So they went to the masjid to pray Salat al-Isha. And as they come into the masjid, they start praying and so on. And as soon as Salah finishes, these two brothers, okay, the two brothers from Guinea, from Africa, Guinea. In fact, they're all technically from different parts of Africa. But you have Brother Ibrahim and Brother Mamadou. Okay? Brother Ibrahim and Brother Mamadou, they were the first two people that left the masjid. So the salah finished and they were, you know, got their shoes and they went out. And as soon as they walked outside of the masjid, the shooter was there. And the shooter shot them and killed them right in front of the masjid. Okay? Now, when that happened, the brothers that were inside the masjid, they heard the noise. They heard the commotion happening on the inside, on the outside, and they got concerned. They didn't really know what it was initially. You just started hearing these loud sounds. But some of the bullets actually went right through the window. Now, when I was there, let me see if I have the picture here. I took pictures of... No, I didn't... No, I don't have it there. So I took pictures of the masjid itself, and subhanAllah, you can see three bullet holes, pretty big, going right through the front window. Now the windows are really thick, almost an inch thick, like the really nice solid windows, tempered, etc. And so this concerned the brothers, or startled the brothers inside who just finished praying salah. Now, some of the brothers also had finished and they were, you know, walking away from the masjid, just like they're, you know, we would do. We'd leave out the back, and the door to exit the masjid is out the back, right? So not on the side here, but straight in the back. So they finished from the front row and they started walking towards the back. And as the one of the brothers who is still in critical condition in the hospital, his name is Brother Ayman, he was walking towards the back door of the masjid to leave, and the shooter came in. And as soon as the shooter came in, he was face to face with Brother Ayman. Now, the shooter shot Brother Ayman. This is where it might get a little bit more detailed in terms of graphics, but you won't see anything. He shot him and it hit him right in the neck. Okay? He's not dead. He's still in the hospital, alhamdulillah. But he's in very critical condition. He shot him in the neck. The bullet stopped right next to his spine. And obviously when that happened, immediately Brother Ayman fell down to the ground, right? He fell right to the ground, and the shooter decided to, you know, unload the rest of his bullets in Brother Ayman. So he shot the rest of his rounds in him. So he had seven bullets in him. Now the doctors only took a couple out. He still has, I think, five bullets left inside his body because it's too dangerous to remove them. They're in very critical, you know, areas, too dangerous for them to go in and operate and remove these bullets. So they just left them there where they are, and they just fixed the wounds, patched it up, and left it. When I went to see him, subhanAllah, this, you know, there's no picture of him there, but I'll have a picture of him in the hospital. And this is one that he allowed me to put on Facebook, but I still haven't, okay? I spoke to him. Okay, this is him in the hospital. He's in bed. He's paralyzed. He's paralyzed. He speaks, but see, he's only been speaking for 2 days at the time when I went to see him. He's still in intensive care. They removed the respirator, right, the machine that was helping him to breathe, the day before we went to see him. And one of the brothers who was taking us around to see all the families, one of the, you know, board members of the masjid, he is actually a doctor in this hospital. Okay, so he obviously, with his permission, you know, brought us in, brought me in there as well, and managed to see Brother Ayman, subhanAllah, and he was laying there. Now, the way he speaks is with no voice. It's just air. So he can move his mouth, but no sound comes out. He's just moving his mouth, and the air, you know, is coming out as he's breathing, but you can't hear him. So you have to lip read. And alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, blessed me with the opportunity to learn how to speak French and learn how to speak Arabic. And those are the languages that most of the Muslims there speak. French, because they live in Quebec City, and Arabic, because a lot of them came from Algeria, Tunisia, Morocco, the Northern African countries. So this brother, subhanallah, Ayman, as he's nearing the door, the shooter comes in, shoots him once in the neck, he falls down, and then he shoots the rest of his bullets in him. Didn't kill him, alhamdulillah. And the brothers say a lot of good things about Brother Ayman. They say, you know, he took 7 lives of people in his own self. As in, this shooter could have killed 7 other people with those bullets, but Brother Ayman's body, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, allowed him to absorb these bullets, right? And protect others through that. Now, as soon as this happened, when the brothers saw that the shooter was out of his bullets, he had no more bullets left in his gun, Brother Izzuddin, going back to that picture, Brother Izzuddin, this brother right here, who's the known as the butcher, right? He has a butcher shop, sells halal meat, a halal, you know, meat store, grocery store. This brother immediately, he said, let's go, let's jump on him, he's done his bullets. So they started running, him and another brother who's now out of the hospital, he just returned home, he was shot in the leg twice. So they started running at him, the shooter shot that brother in the leg and shot Brother Izzuddin and killed him. Okay, so Brother Izzuddin died right at the entrance of the door, okay, going into the masjid. Then what happened, subhanAllah, the shooter, you know, started to shoot at the rest of the people, and I won't show those pictures because they're very, you know, bloody and graphic. But one of the things that I want to share with you is, you know, the experience from meeting the families, right? The experience from meeting these family members. So I went to Brother Izzuddin's house, okay? I met with his son, his daughter, his wife, his brother-in-law, sister-in-law, niece, and so on. They were all there. They, you know, got together to meet us and welcome us. And subhanAllah, it was really interesting. I actually never knew, but my dad knows this brother. And it wasn't until I was leaving Quebec City, I was in the airport, my flight was delayed about 5 hours, and I called my parents to speak to them from Quebec City. And my father was telling me, he says, did you go to Brother Izzuddin's place? Did you see his family? Is everyone okay? I said, yeah. Why are you asking me about him? He says, I know him because my dad's close friend is a brother in Montreal who supplies meat, like wholesale supply of halal meat. He goes, his operation is basically, he goes to the farms, he sacrifices a bunch of animals for whoever, all the meat stores that need, and then he transports them. And Brother Izzuddin used to come to Montreal and pick up his meat and drive back to Quebec City every couple of weeks. And so my dad used to meet him regularly, right? He said, I've met him like 3-4 times very recently, subhanAllah. Now, Brother Izzuddin, if you look behind him, there's a picture of the Kaaba, right? You see the Kaaba behind him. That was taken about 2 weeks before he was shot and killed. He finally saved enough money to take his family, his wife and children, for Umrah. And they went for Umrah. And he was so happy, he was so excited. You know, he was telling the brothers when he came back, I'm so relieved, finally I got to take my family for Umrah. And he didn't live much longer after that. That's Brother Izzuddin. Brother Khalid, okay, this brother, Brother Khalid, he, subhanAllah, was a university professor. His wife and him were, you know, colleagues. They taught in the same department at the University of Laval. They were not only husband and wife, but they were colleagues and co-workers at the university. They used to teach together. And this brother, subhanAllah, when I was lecturing in Quebec City, so I did a lecture in French, you can go on YouTube and see it. I did a lecture in French and, you know, we recorded it there. Right where they set up the table and my chair, immediately underneath me, the carpet is, you know, green. Right underneath me, you could see still the stain of the blood, like a big puddle of blood. He was a brother who died right there. And that's where I'm sitting. Now, they cleaned it and disinfected it, obviously. They painted the walls, alhamdulillah, so you can't see, you know, whatever damage there was to the walls, they repaired that. But the carpet itself is too expensive to change. So they just had it disinfected and cleaned as best as possible, but it still was stained. And so right where I'm sitting, the brothers are telling me, you know, right here, that spot, right where I was, is where he died, subhanAllah. Right in the front of the masjid, you'll see in the pictures next to the mihrab, where, you know, where the imam is standing, just next to it is that stain of blood on the carpet, and that's where he passed away. He was shot and killed there. Now, subhanAllah, this brother, you know, came to Canada and worked really hard, was teaching at the university, was a professor, and leaves behind his family. But we'll give you more examples. These two brothers now, Ibrahim and brother Mamadou. These two brothers, we went to see their families as well. What's really interesting about these two brothers is that their children are extremely young. In fact, I have a picture of brother Mamadou's children. Okay, I'll show you that inshallah. And I was telling the brothers and sisters there in Quebec City, I said, you know, they will probably never ever remember their father. That's how young they are, these children, subhanAllah. Right? They'll probably never ever remember their father. And you see how they're sitting with me? We came in and I just smiled at them, and they came and they sat on my lap and they started to play with me as though nothing happened. Now, it's really interesting because many of us would never think that we would ever be in a situation like that. We would never assume that our children are not going to grow up without us. Like, we always think we're going to be there and we'll be there forever for our children. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us that lesson that we may not be there forever. And his children are so young, brother Mamadou's children, look, they're super young. In fact, they took my glasses and they distorted them and warped them, and they were only a couple of weeks old. But I really didn't care, because these are children who lost a father. Why should I care about my sunglasses, right? So subhanAllah, these children, they will probably never remember their father growing up and only know him from pictures and articles and the news and things that they see online, Wikipedia, etc. Okay? So that's brother Mamadou and brother Ibrahim as well. Very nice, very humble brothers, you know, subhanAllah. I met brother Ibrahim's mom. She had come and she was staying with them. She's very old, subhanAllah. I think I have a picture of them as well. You know, really, really old. And she's saying, it's just not fair. It's just not right. Like, my son, you know, he didn't really do anything. Sorry, bro. That's me in the airport terminal. He didn't really do anything to harm anybody else. Why would someone want to harm him, right? And so subhanAllah, is very interesting to hear that story. Now, the other two brothers, I'll go to this brother, and this brother, you know, his children teach us a very beautiful lesson. I'll leave him for last. This brother here, brother Abu Bakr, right? Brother Abu Bakr, he's the first family that we went to go visit. Like, his family, his wife, and his son and daughter, the very first family that we went to visit. And one lesson that we learn from every single one of the wives of these brothers, and I'll share it with regards to her, because she was the first one we went to visit and she was the first one to say it. She said, one thing that I request from every single Muslim out there that you go and visit, convey this message to them. She says, tell them never ever to forget the brothers and the people that were in the masjid when the shooting happened, but did not get injured. And I was like, what? Remember those that were there that did not get injured? She said, yeah, tell those that you meet, tell people, remember in your dua, when you speak to them, tell them to remember the brothers and sisters and the children, because there were children in the basement of the masjid downstairs, right? They're actually classrooms. They were there downstairs, a few of them, because, you know, they have classrooms down there and so on, so they went down. And subhanAllah, she says, tell the people to remember in their dua the brothers and sisters that were there in the masjid, but witnessed everything and did not get injured, because they are traumatized. Like, from what they saw, it was very difficult. When I was lecturing them in the masjid, you know, I just like this, I'm sitting down speaking, and there were about double the amount of people that were here, at least, in the masjid. And you would think that these people are scared now to come to the masjid, that, you know, they feel something else might happen, or no, I can't go back to that place because that was the place where my friend or my father or my uncle or my brother or my best friend, you know, was shot and killed. But subhanAllah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تَقُولُوا لِمَن يُقْتَلُ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أَمْوَاتٍ بَلْ أَحْيَاءٌ وَلَكِنْ لَا تَشْعُرُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, do not say The man yuqtal, those who were killed in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are people in the masjid. They were sitting in the masjid. They just finished praying Salat al-Isha. Allah says, do not say about them that they are dead. Bal ahya. Verily, they are still alive. How they're alive, we leave this with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But we know that they themselves, as people who die in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, especially being inside a place, you know, so sacred as the masjid of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, immediately after praying Salat al-Isha, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, those who are killed in certain ways, in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are still alive. Don't say about them that they're dead. So we say that they're dead in our English language, as in, you know, when we're talking, they were shot and killed, for example. But subhanAllah, they are with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a special position. Now this brother's wife, she was the very first one who broke the ice for us. Like, she brought tears to our eyes. And she was like, you know, you don't know how hard it is for some of these families. She says, we lost our breadwinner. We lost a person that would bring food to the table of our homes, who would earn money to pay the rent, to buy things for children, for the children, who would come home after a long day of working and just spend some time with the family. And we lost that person. And this brother, subhanAllah, brother Abu Bakr, his best friend was with us. And he says, when I came to this city, when I came to Quebec City, it was Abu Bakr that took me out to find a job. He took me to find an apartment. He took me to buy my groceries. He took me to, you know, buy the furniture that I needed. And he was known in our community as the person that would get everyone settled. Any new Muslim that came to the community, he would reach out to them immediately and ask them, what do you need? Can I take you, you know, around? How can I help you and assist you? And he was the person that would always put himself forward. And he was known in the community. When we went to the masjid, every single one of the brothers, we would ask them about this person and that person. And they would say about him, about Abu Bakr, that he was the person that would make sure everyone in the community was okay. Like, he was the Amir of the community. SubhanAllah. And when you look at them, you know, as Muslims, we tend to judge people. Like, you would look at them and say, oh, the only religious one is the one standing in front of the Kaaba. No, not at all. These were all brothers that were known for praying in the front row of the masjid on a regular basis. They were known for being in the masjid in the front row on a regular basis. SubhanAllah. The last brother here that we'll mention, and then there's a few others that we went to visit in the hospital. Two brothers that we went to see in the hospital. One of them I spoke about already. This brother, subhanAllah, Abdul Karim, very, very interesting story. And this is for the children and the parents. Brother Abdul Karim, his wife, when we went to see her and the family, she didn't cry. Her eyes began to tear at one point in time, but she didn't cry. And she was the only one that really showed, I mean, they were all very strong, don't get me wrong. In fact, none of the wives showed that they were, you know, really disturbed. They had gotten past it. They accepted that this was from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But one thing that Brother Abdul Karim's wife shared with us, a few things that she shared with us, was, you know, touching. It touched the heart. She says, on that day, at around lunchtime, their three daughters were at home, okay, earlier in the day. And the father, he took his phone, right? Takes his phone and he shows the three daughters. One of the daughters is 9, the other one is 5 or 6, and the younger one, she's almost 2 years old. He takes his phone and he shows them this 2-minute video, 2 or 3 minutes. And it's a video of a little boy who's 12 years old. Anyone here 12 years old? Who here's 12? You're 12? Stand up. Let's just see how old you are. Yeah, both of you, stand up. So that's 12 years old, right? You could sit down. These two boys, right? They're roughly around 12 years old. He's showing his daughters a video of a 12-year-old boy in France. Okay, so the video's in French. And the boy is saying good advice. He's telling people, he says, you know what, I have health conditions. I'm going to have open heart surgery. And he was in the hospital going into an operation. He's like, I'm going to have open heart surgery. And I have to have transplant of certain vital organs. And this is my health condition. But I want to tell people to be brave. And I want to tell people to have an outlook in life. to think of their life as something that's a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That you're going to live a long time and you're going to achieve a lot of things. And you'll be able to do this and you'll be able to do that and you'll be able to grow old and so on and so forth. And this is a very short video, but he's telling people that. And when the video ends, Brother Abdul Karim, he points to the phone, right, to the video, and he tells his three daughters, he says, "You see this boy? I want you girls to be brave just like this boy." He says to his daughters, "I want you girls to be brave just like this boy." And that night, only about 7-8 hours later, Brother Abdul Karim goes to the masjid and is shot there in the masjid and dies and doesn't return home. And when his wife finds out, she's crying, she's sad, she doesn't know how she's going to tell her children. And she, you know, gets her children together and, you know, tries to figure out how to tell them. And she tells them, "You know what, there was an incident at the masjid and someone came in and Baba is gone." And they're like, "What do you mean Baba's gone? Baba was shot and he was killed and he died. Baba's not coming home anymore." And the mother is crying. Like, she's crying uncontrollably. You can imagine her husband. Like, she just saw him minutes ago and now he went to the masjid and he's done. He's gone. He's gone. He died. And she's telling the children, you know what the 9-year-old daughter says to her mom? She says, "Mom, you remember the video that Baba showed us today? The video about that boy, the 12-year-old boy? Baba told us to be brave. So Mom, be brave. Because Baba told us that he wants us to be brave just like that boy. So we need to be brave and you need to be brave too, Mama. So don't be sad. Allah has gone to a good place. Allah is okay, don't worry. He's gonna go to Jannah." Now the next day, subhanAllah, she says, you know what her other daughter tells her? Her other daughter tells her, "You remember Baba used to talk about paradise?" And she's telling us this story. She says, "My husband, Abdul Karim, this brother right here, she says, he used to teach our daughters, about Jannah and Jahannam. And he always used to say, you need to be really good. Because when you're good, you go to Jannah and you're going to go to paradise. You're going to get all these nice things and good things. And you know, so many nice things are going to happen to you." And then she says, he also used to tell them about Jahannam. And how in Jahannam you get punished if you do the bad things that Allah doesn't like. You'll go to Jahannam. So make sure that you never do any bad things because you don't want to go to Jahannam. And the next day, subhanAllah, they get up and obviously the day was chaotic. Like, she had to go to the hospital. She had to identify the body of her husband. You know, someone is looking after the children. It was really, really difficult for them. They were very disturbed, subhanAllah. You can imagine, like, everything just turns upside down. The whole country, the whole world knew about this incident. And she says her other daughter, who's 5, almost 6 years old, she says, "Mama, you know, Dad used to tell us, Baba used to tell us about Jannah and Jahannam. And Baba used to always say that good people go to Jannah. And Baba was a good person. So Allah wouldn't punish him. Allah would put him in Jannah. Don't be sad. Don't cry. Everything's going to be okay because Baba went to Jannah." And she said, you know what she said to her mom? She said, "Baba is so happy because Allah put him in paradise. And paradise is a place where Allah puts good people. And Baba now, he's with his mama and Baba. With their grandparents, right?" She says, "Now he's okay. He's happy because he finally gets to see his parents." Now we know the life of the barzakh, right? But this is a little child. She's 5 years old, right? She's 5 years old. She's saying this to her mom. "Don't worry, everything's going to be okay." And she told her mom, "Mama, now we have to be really good people so that when we die and we go back to Allah, Allah puts us in Jannah too, and then we get to see Baba again." SubhanAllah. Like, when she was saying that, the mother, she's not crying. We were crying. We just, you know, subhanAllah, it was so difficult to hear a mother say these things, that her children are telling her to be brave. And her children are telling her, "Don't cry. It's okay. Everything's going to be fine. We just need to be good and Allah's going to put us in paradise." And when you think of it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us, you know, about Jannah and about our parents. In the Quran, Allah says, "Wala taqul lahuma uff." And we know how hard it's going to be dealing with our parents. For the youth here, we know, right? Parents, they're tough on us, right? They want to give us things that we want, but they don't give it to us when we want it. We have to grow up and get it, right? And subhanAllah, it's very difficult. And for those of us that are older, We know very well that dealing with our parents is not something that's easy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that it's hard for us. But what are the three categories? In Surah Ar-Ra'd, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about Jannah, talks about Jahannam, then talks about the people of Jannah, and then says about the people of Jannah that they will be welcomed by angels. And just before he says that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, they will be returned to those who they loved. From amongst their parents, from amongst their siblings, from amongst their parents, from amongst their spouses, and amongst their children. Subhanallah. Why? Because the people that love us and that we love are the people that are most valuable to us. And even though it's hard for us to deal with them, like we all have issues with our parents, right? We all have issues with our children. We all have issues with our spouse. Husband and wife argue like all the time, subhanAllah, hopefully not, right? But regularly we see some people constantly fighting. And for others it's once in a while, but when they argue, subhanAllah, they at times say things like, I don't even know why I married you. Right? That's how it is for some people. I know, I counsel people all the time. Right? People say some of the worst things to each other. But at the same time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us that the people who make us most frustrated, the people that are so difficult to get along with in this life, are the people that are worthy to be in Jannah with us. Like our wife, our husband, our children, our parents are the people that are worthy of being in Jannah with us. So yeah, it's going to be hard. Do we think that we're going to just earn Jannah? It's going to be super easy to go to paradise? No. أَمْ حَسِبْتُمْ أَن تَدْخُلُوا الْجَنَّةَ وَلَمَّا يَأْتِكُمْ مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ خَلَوْا مِن قَبْلِكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you think you're just going to get into Jannah? It's just going to be that easy? And you haven't even been tested like the people of the past have been tested? Now subhanAllah, getting into Jannah, getting into paradise is not going to be easy. It's a difficult test. And for these brothers and those sisters and family members and children, it's a test that they're going through. But one thing that I learned about that community in Quebec City is that they are so close-knit and so united that the children of Abdul Karim, right? The three daughters, the two older daughters, the younger one, she doesn't really speak much. The two older daughters, the five-year-old and the nine-year-old, you know what they were saying? On the day that the masjid reopened, they were saying, Mama, hurry up, we're going to be late for class. We need to go back to the masjid. Baba was never late taking us to class. We don't want to be late. Hurry up, hurry up, hurry up, right? That's what they were saying to their mom. Now when you think of it, where were they going? They were going right back to the place where their father was killed. He was shot, but they were saying, no, Mama, hurry up, we need to go. We need to get ready, we have to be at class. We need to get there. And subhanAllah, that teaches us how brave our children are and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested a community to teach us how strong we need to be and how strong our children need to be and how important it is to teach our children about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That when anything difficult happens to them, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us that in Surah Yunus, right? Verses number 62 and 63. He says, Ala inna awliya Allahi la khawfun alayhim wa la hum yahzanun. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ala inna awliya Allah. Those people who are like connected to Allah, friends of Allah, very, very, you know, linked to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, Ala inna awliya Allah. La khawfun alayhim. They don't have fear. They're not scared. These people are not scared. La khawfun alayhim wa la hum yahzanun. And they're not people who get sad, who just, you know, become really sad and depressed all the time. Now I'll tell you, subhanAllah, the next morning, Sunday morning, before we flew out, we went to meet the survivors. They call them the survivors, right? That's what, like, you know, the media and so on calls them. The people that were in the masjid that helped those that were shot, but they themselves did not get shot. We went to meet them, all 39 of them. And subhanAllah, these brothers, mashallah. One of them was telling me, you know, a few of them had said some really interesting stories, but one of them, he says, you know, Dawood, every single time I go to the masjid now, and they still go to the masjid. That's what's really interesting. He says, every single time I go to the masjid and I reach to the door handle to open the door, just like we reach to the door handle outside the masjid to open the door. He says, every single time I put my hand out to hold on to the handle to open the door, in front of me, my brain shows me a picture of the shooter right in front of me. He says, every single time I reach out to open the door, I see the shooter in front of me. And I walk past him to go pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, every single time I go to the masjid now, every single time I open the door, I see the shooter right in front of me. It's real for them. It's real. But these people, لا خوف عليهم ولا هم يحزنون. They are, subhanAllah, so linked with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that they themselves don't feel that fear. They still go to the masjid because they know that the protection is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what does Allah say in the next verse? Who are these people? Who are the people who don't feel that sadness? Who are the people who don't get scared? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَكَانُوا يَتَّقُونَ. Those who believe, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, all of us, وَكَانُوا يَتَّقُونَ, and throughout their lives there were people who were conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who had taqwa, connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When hardship comes to them, they don't fail. It hurts them, yes, they fall down, no doubt, but they get back up. They don't fall down and get hurt and stay down, they get back up. SubhanAllah, these brothers got back up. One of the brothers that we went to see, the other brother, I mentioned Brother Ayman to you, the one who's in critical condition. There's another one who's still in the hospital. Imagine, for 2 months now they're in the hospital. I can still remember the feeling. I put my hands on Brother Ayman, the brother I showed you in the hospital bed. I put my hands on him. I gave him salam. I rubbed his head, you know, I was talking to him. He was so happy. He had this big smile on his face. I'm telling you the truth, subhanAllah, he was crying. I took a tissue and I was wiping his tears away, but he had this huge smile on his face. And he was saying the shahada, and he was saying, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to make everything fine, everything's going to be good. And he says, don't forget me in your dua. And he himself was also saying, don't forget those that were there that night. SubhanAllah. And I could still remember the feeling on my fingers of putting my hand on his head and holding his hand, the skin. You know the skin of a person who's in the hospital for a long time? It feels like sticky, right? It feels very interesting, subhanAllah, right? I don't even know how to explain it. I could still feel that feeling. And I don't think I will ever, ever forget that feeling of someone who, subhanAllah, stood strong like an Iron Man, like Khalid ibn Walid. With literally, you could see all over him, subhanAllah, he's got, you know, problems. He has stitches left, right, and center. Wounds, bullet holes inside of him. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed him to be someone that absorbed those bullets. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant him a long life upon iman. The other brother, Brother Sa'id, who we went to see, subhanAllah. You know, Brother Sa'id, mashallah. He is still in the hospital. Inshallah, we hope that he's going to be released very soon. He also was shot quite a few times, and he survived. And he was there the day, about 3 or 4 days before we went to see him. He was released from the, there's a ward that deals with burns. Now, he wasn't burnt in the masjid, but because of his body going through so much treatment, and a reaction to certain medications that he was given in the hospital and was taking, his body started to burn. Like the skin on his body started to burn. Like fire had touched him, but no fire was around, right? So he started getting all these bumps and stuff all over his skin. They put him in this ward that dealt with burns and trauma and so on. And he was released, alhamdulillah. We went to see him. He was in, you know, still in intensive care, trauma unit. But alhamdulillah, he was doing much better. And he was sitting up in his bed and we managed to speak to him. And this brother, subhanAllah, was so simple. He was someone who would lead Salatul Jum'ah. He came to Canada about 8 years ago and he was a professor back in his country. When he came to Canada, he had a real difficult time, very hard time finding a job. Okay, he was a professor in geology, if I'm not mistaken. And so he started to drive a taxi. For all these years, he's driving a taxi. Now think of it. Someone whose husband is a taxi driver, but he's not driving his taxi for 2 months. where does the family get money from? Where's their income? The income comes in when he gets in his taxi and drives. For 2 months, he can't drive. Where's the money coming from? And so, subhanAllah, when we went and we met them, one of the things that we did, now, Canada Zakat and Da'wah, they managed to raise online $402,000. $402,000 from approximately 6,000 people that donated, and 70%, 70% of the people who donated were not Muslim. $402,000. And the lawyers, subhanAllah, that they dealt with to try and figure out how to disburse, how to give this money out to those family members, to these six, as well as to the two families of the brothers that are still in the hospital, they decided to give each one of them for just over $42,000 each. So we meet Brother Saeed in the hospital, and his wife came in. We were there, and his wife, she was out, and she came in. She went to get the children, I think, from, maybe they had class at the masjid or something, and she brought them to the hospital. And we were saying to her, you know, we've divided up the money in a certain way with the lawyers. They decided that this would be the best way to divide the money. And so we have category one, which gets $42,000, and then we have category two, which gets just over $10,000 or $11,000. Those are the people that were injured but are still able to go back to work and so on. And so she was confused. She says, so how much are we going to get? And when we said, well, Brother Saeed, he's still very injured. He's in critical condition, still in the hospital. So he gets $42,000. They broke down crying. They just couldn't imagine. They couldn't imagine how Muslims and people from Toronto, from the rest of Canada, from Mississauga, Oakville, etc., would put together an online campaign to raise over $400,000 to go and give to them. And she was extremely surprised. How is this even possible? But the husband himself, Brother Saeed, he cried for the next 25 minutes. For 25 minutes. And he kept saying, you have no idea how difficult it's been for my family. We can't pay rent. We're selling things. We don't know what to do. My wife is confused. We didn't know how to move forward. It was extremely hard for them. And he says, he was so thankful. Jazakumullahu khairan. Extremely, extremely thankful. He says, this really, really helps us. He says, I really hope that very soon, inshallah, I'll be able to leave, and then I have to go through rehab, and inshallah, maybe within a year, after that year, I should be able to go back to work. So this should be good. This will help us, inshallah, to survive for another year, and then, inshallah, I'll be able to go back to work and resume, and things will be good for us, inshallah. Look at how, subhanAllah, they were so touched that Muslims would go out of their way to raise money. And I started to think to myself, why wouldn't we? As Muslims, why would we not go out of our way to help others? Of course we should. But the amount of overhead costs that these families had was unbelievable. Like taking taxis back and forth, paying parking at the hospital. We all know how expensive it is to pay for parking at a hospital. Like they could not even pay parking. The wife would take the bus to go to the hospital because, subhanAllah, it's cheaper to do that than to pay for parking to go there. And still be a single mom at home, as in, her husband's in the hospital, look after the children, take them to classes and pick them up and make their food and so on and so forth. SubhanAllah, it's such a beautiful thing our deen has taught us to make sure that we look after our Muslim brothers and sisters. Here's a picture, just in conclusion, of those that were in the masjid, SubhanAllah, they survived, but they were the ones that spent the next few days wide awake, going to the hospital, going to the morgue, identifying bodies, finding those that were lost. SubhanAllah, some people, they didn't even know where their loved ones were. They couldn't reach them. Cell phones were lost and dropped on the floor and so on. It was chaotic, SubhanAllah. And so see, these are the brothers that were there, SubhanAllah. No, this is at a community center. The masjid itself, This, I'll show you a picture. This is also one of the brothers. He's a barber, but he's very traumatized. He can't go back to work. He has his own barber shop. We went to see him. He was the brother who ran at the shooter with Brother Izzuddin. So Brother Izzuddin was shot and killed, and this brother ran at him to try and tackle him, and he was shot in the leg a few times, and you could see in his toe. What they did was they inserted a pin to keep his foot straight because the bones are completely shattered in there. So they removed the nail and they inserted a pin through his foot to keep his foot straight. And subhanAllah, he just recently, a few days he was released from the hospital just before we went to see him. He's at home, but he's very traumatized. When he thinks of the moment, he just breaks down. He breaks down. It's very difficult for him to go back to work. He said he can't right now. He might even sell his barbershop, because every single person in the community, subhanAllah, would go to him. His barbershop was just across the street from the masjid, and he would, cut the hair of so many brothers, and every time he sees them, he just breaks down. It's very difficult for him. Pictures inside the masjid, I'll show you, inshallah, if I have a few here, if I can access this. I had it open, I think it's here, Google. Yeah, so I don't want to show too many pictures because some of them are a little bit graphic. Just give me a second, inshallah. I mean, you can always Google this. I have some on my phone, but I didn't. When my wife told me not to, here we go. So this is like, hold on. Okay, so how big is that? I don't know how big that is. Oh, I did the same thing. Mushkila. Okay, so this is like inside the masjid. I didn't really want to show this because of the children. Where did it go? Anyways, you can go to Google, inshallah, and check out any pictures that you want to see there on Google. Let me try and get back to it. This is also, the pillar where another brother was shot. Here you have the front of the masjid. I'm just trying to find a... Forgive me. So in the front of the masjid, this is the entrance area. In the front of the masjid, I don't see the picture here right now. But right in the front here, very similar to this, there's like a spot that went in for the mihrab type of thing, the minbar. And so all the brothers that were in the front row, they literally all started running into that room. So they all tried to cram into that room. And the shooter basically, made it very easy for him, subhanAllah. He just had to shoot in one area. And then one of the brothers, I believe he was the brother that was leading salah, because they don't actually have a fixed imam at that masjid. So one of the brothers that was leading salah, who they consider the imam, he came out of that room and he ran to the door that goes downstairs. So right in the front of the masjid, like here, right over there, there's a door that goes down to the basement to get all the children and whoever was in there into one room and lock the door to make sure the shooter doesn't come. So he was injured, but he still ran to try and get downstairs. Alhamdulillah, he made it through the door and downstairs to secure that area, subhanAllah. So it was a very, difficult time for them, very disturbing, subhanAllah. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make it easy for our Muslim brothers and sisters. They, in fact, invited me to come tonight, right now, as we speak. They have a dinner for the very first time. All the families of those that were, that lost their husbands, as well as the survivors and so on, they're getting together. You can open the lights, inshallah, just there, open the lights. And so they actually have a dinner tonight. They invited me and my family down, but I said I need to come here for the halaqa. So I didn't want to miss our halaqa here tonight. But they're having their very first dinner together as a community after the incident, and sharing some moments with each other and support and so on.